Is it live on Zoom now?
Okay, so good morning, and we are live together with Tianga. I feel very privileged to introduce the second keynote today, Dr. Tianga Talagala. And before I start with the formal introduction, just let me say that actually it wasn't that easy to get Tianga on board, but luckily some things in her schedule altered and she was able to join our conference. And we feel very happy because actually Tianga represents the field of data science that we consider a bit not as hyped as others. So forecasting. And just to briefly introduce Tianga, she has a PhD in statistics from Monash University, and she was doing her PhD under the tutelage of the Rob Hindman, who will be joining us for the next talk and also for the prediction versus forecasting panel. But aside to her academic achievements that we really appreciate, I want to mention that Tianga is incredibly active in the field as a R lady. She organized the first R ladies chapter in Sri Lanka. So aside to this scientific excellence, Tianga is contributing to the growth of the data science community, which we as YR Foundation deeply appreciate, and we share this and we share these ideas. So Tianga, without further ado, the floor is yours.
Okay, so good morning, good afternoon, and good day, depending on where you are. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thanks for having me. It's a great honor to be here. Let me share my slides. Okay, I hope my slides are up now, so let's get right into it. Time series forecasting is one of my real interest in the work I do. In this talk, I'm going to talk about a feature-based algorithm for large-scale time series forecasting. Forecasting is a key activity for any business to operate efficiently. It plays a role in business decision making. It plays a key role in business decision-making process. For example, large-scale businesses need to forecast demand for their products, for capacity planning to optimize resource allocation, set targets to evaluate their performance relative to the baseline, and many more. Let's focus on forecasting the demand for a single product. So here I have sales data for bananas from June 2011 to November 2021. On the right-hand side, I have the visualization of the data. This is called the historical behavior of the data. But what I'm interested is what is the future behavior of the data? What is happening after this pink vertical line? So in particularly, I'm interested about how much will you see over the next 12 months? How much do we need to produce and when? So in order to answer these questions, we need forecast. So in order to produce forecasts for the values in the future periods, I need to estimate the model using historical data. Okay, here, what I'm trying to do is I would like to put out this schematic here to show what might happen during a typical model building process. So model building process always starts with data wrangling. So that's the process of cleaning data, organizing data, and transforming data into a desired format. And of course, then you need to visualize data in order to understand your data and also to decide which models to use. After that, sometimes you need to do data pre-processing, maybe split data into a training set and test set. Sometimes you need to address the outliers. Sometimes you need, if you have missing values, you need to impute missing values. There are several things. Again, sometimes after processing, again, sometimes you need to visualize data. And after that, we have model building, model tuning, and evaluate forecast accuracy. So you can see this is an iterative process. You have to build several models. You have to estimate several models. You have to tune several models. And you have to get the forecast accuracy over the test set. So after that, you have to evaluate the model. You have to select the best forecasting approach for a given time series. Sometimes again, you need to visualize data, visualize the forecasting results. And the important thing is you need to communicate these results back to the corresponding parties. So you can see, even with the single time series, we have quite a lot of work to do. But when it comes to large scale retail companies, it's not just for one single product. You need to forecast demand for multiple products. And again, it's not just for one single location. You have to give the demand. So you have to give the forecast for multiple products across many warehouses. So you can see this generates many thousands of time series. So when you have one series, the plotting is quite easy. This is how it looks like. When you have two time series, this is the case. Okay, three, and here comes the 10. And here comes when you have more than 100 time series. So you can see it is even hard to visualize data. The other approach that you could use here is you can plot all of these time series in individual panels. But unfortunately, humans are not that patient enough to look at all of these time series plots. So the main question is how to forecast large number of univariate time series. So there are two approaches. One of the approach is this is called the aggregate selection rule. So aggregate selection rule is you use a single method is used to compute forecast across all time series. For example, let's say random walk with drift. You are going to use random walk with drift to generate forecast across all time series. But unfortunately, according to the no free lunch theorem, there is no single model that performs best on all kinds of time series. So this approach, aggregate selection approach, doesn't work. So the next approach is individual model building. So if we go back to the brute force approach, what you need to do is you have to repeat this model building process large number of times. If you have 1000 time series, you have to repeat this 1000 times. So you can see this is not a computationally efficient process. This is time. This is costly in terms of time and computing. So the question is how to choose the right forecasting technique for each and every time series. So clearly there is a need for a fast and scalable algorithm to automate the process of selecting models with the aim of forecasting. So we refer to that as forecast model selection. So the big question is, one side you have a large collection of time series and other side you have different forecasting methods. We call this one as the problem space and we call this one as the algorithm space. The problem is to identify the suitable forecasting method. Problem is to match these things. So before moving to my algorithm, I would like to show this six time series. And what I did was I used my approach, this model building process for each and every time series, and I identified the best forecasting model for each and every time series. So from here, you can see for this one, for the series 1 and 624, random walk with the drift gives the best forecast. For 633 and 645, these two, naive method produced the best forecast. And for this one, exponential smoothing method produced the best forecast. And for the last one, Sarima models gives the most accurate forecast. So my question is, why random walk with the drift works well on these two time series? Why Nayu method works well on these two time series? In general, why some methods work well and others do not? So if you observe these time series, you can see these time series have different features. If you look at these two time series, they have a strong trend. And if you look at the last time series, we can see there's a strong trend as well as a seasonal pattern. And for this one here, we can see there's no trend, but there's a seasonal pattern. So I'm going to see whether we can use the features of time series in guiding us selecting the forecasting models. So here in this, so features are can be considered as characteristics of time series. Machine learning community, they tend to call time series features. They are actually summary measures, numerical summary measures of time series. Actually, John W. Tukey came up with the idea of time series features, which he called cognostics, computer-aided diagnostic. So the main principle is you have a time series, you have set of raw values, and from based on this time series, you compute a vector of features. So for the illustration here, I considered two features, strength of trend and strength of seasonality. You can see for the first four series, strength of seasonality is zero. And for these series, the strength of trend is very high. These are calculated based on these measurements. I'll provide the link to my paper. Then you can read about the measurements thoroughly later. Then what I did was I plotted strength of seasonality versus strength of trend. So you can see this series is lying here, and here this one has a very strong seasonality, but a very low trend. And these two, they have very high trend value, but a very low seasonality. These two are very similar. So that's why they are lying together in the feature space. So I call this one time domain representation. The other one I called as feature domain representation. So my goal is to check whether we can use these in features to guide us in selecting the best forecasting model. There are many features that you could think of: length, autocorrelation coefficient, maybe the mean value of the series, a variance, number of beats, number of proportion of zeros, spectral entropy. There are many features that you could think of. In this case, we use 25 features for yearly time series and more than 40 features for the quarterly time, seasonal time series. Okay, let's go to my algorithm. So algorithm starts with the population. This is the population of time series that I want to forecast. From this population, I take a sample of time series. And furthermore, I split all time series into a training set and a test set. Then I extracted features from the training part of the time series. In addition to that, I fit several models to the training part of the time series. And after that, I compute forecast accuracy measures over the test set. Based on this one, I label each time series according to the best forecasting method. For example, in this case, the lowest accuracy is given by the ETS model. So I label this time series as ETS. For the second series, I label it as ARIMA model. So now, features becomes the X variables, independent variables to my algorithm. The best forecasting method becomes the Y label or the dependent variable to my algorithm. So we have features and we have class labels. So we can use supervised learning algorithm to model the relationship between the features and the best forecasting model. So in this case, I use a random forest algorithm, and the result trained model is called the Metalla. So this is called the offline preface of the algorithm. You need to do this only once. This is computationally heavy, But don't worry, you need to do this only once. So when you have new signed CDs from the population, then what you are going to do is you are going to compute features from the time series and pass it to the trained algorithm, and then it will give you the best forecasting method. For the new time series, you don't need to compute all of the models in our algorithm space. So this algorithm is implemented in my package, in a package called SEAL. The name of the algorithm is FORMS, feature-based forecast model selection. The package is called SEAL. SEAL means the magic ball. And in ancient time, people use this SEAL ball they consider this as a fortune teller object, fortune teller object. And I found this SEAL ball when I went to Acropolis New Museum in Athens. This is a very heavy, very large stone ball, but my SEAL ball is this open source R software package. Now I will introduce the package functionalities. For that, I use data from the M competitions. M competitions are a series of open competitions to evaluate and compare accuracy of different time series and forecasting methods. For the training set, I use several time series from the M1 competition. And for the test set, I use subset of time series from the M3 competition. So first of all, I can compute features from the time series available in my training set. So you can see I have a 181 time series and I computed 25 features. Next, I fit all of these models to each and every time series and compute the forecast accuracy measure. In this case, my forecast accuracy measure, I use maize value as the forecast accuracy measure. Now I have forecast accuracy measure. If you look at the first row, you can see the minimum is given by the ETS model. So this is labeled as ETS model. For the second one, the minimum is given by the random walk with the drift model. So that time series is labeled as random walk with the drift. So this one, so you can see the first one, the model name is ETS with AAN. Second one, random walk with drift. And third one, the class label is ETS-MAN. So when you prepare, when you use the prepare the training set, prepare training set function, it will combine your features. They are your X variables and class labels that's the best forecasting method for each and every time series. Then I use build. So furthermore, in addition to that, I also computed features corresponds to the test set. That's all I do for the test set. I don't want to fit the models for each and every time series in the test set. Then based on build random forest function, I basically pass my training set as well as the features computed for the new time series or the test set. So this will give you the predicted model. So this indicates for the first time series, the best forecasting model is ETS model with a trend component. For the second time series, the best forecasting method is random walk with drift. Third one, random walk with drift. And if you go to this one, it's the best forecasting method for that series is ARIMA. We know that the early M3 time series are highly biased towards the random walk with the drift model. That's why we have a random, but that's why the random walk with this drift is picked from the most of the time series. In addition to that, I have another function, random RF forecast. So when you give the predicted class labels, this function will compute the forecast, the corresponding forecast. You will get the mean forecast as well as the confidence intervals as well. So that's all algorithm, very super fast, super easy, because for the new time series, you only need to compute the features. Okay, next, what we did was we evaluate our algorithm on M4 competition data set. This forms of the results, the first row shows the results of the forms approach. Forms approach yields accurate forecasts comparable to several benchmarks and other commonly used algorithms. The purpose of forms is to not to introduce a algorithm that beats all of the benchmarks, but to introduce an algorithm that performs reasonably well across a wide range of time series and which is relatively fast to implement. There's usually a trade-off when forecasting between accuracy and the computation time, and forms its intent to trade off some accuracy for a large gain in computing time. We also check the computing cost for each time series, and it's really fast. The advantage is you can parallelize the process for a given computing budget. Okay, now the question is, we develop a very big random forest in order to model the relationship between the features and the best forecasting model. The question is, can we trust machine learning algorithms if we don't know how it works? So the next phase of the analysis, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to explore what is happening under the hood of Form's random forest. This is an important aspect in encouraging people to trust and use the proposed framework effectively. It helps to increase the trust in framework. So if people understand the reasons behind the results, they can use their prior knowledge to decide whether to accept the predictions or whether to reject the predictions. Okay, these are the questions that I'm going to explore. I refer to this process as peeking inside Form's random forest. So my questions are, which features are the most important? Where are they important? How are they important? When and how are features linked with the prediction outcomes? And when and how strongly do features interact with other features? So for this one, the first thing that I did was, I'll play this one. Okay. The first thing that I did was, when you train a random forest, you will get this what probability matrix. So here the rows represents the time series and columns represents the class labels that I considered. Ideally, what probability should be 1 for the best forecasting method and 0 for the other class labels. But due to the high similarity in the class labels, we get non-zero probabilities for the other class labels as well. So exploring what matrix probability is, we can identify the form's understanding of the similarities and dissimilarities of the class labels. So here I have rows represent time series and columns represent class labels. And the cell value shows the number of votes received by the time series in that row for that corresponding forecast model. For example, here the first cell value represents the proportion of trees in the random forest that select neural network for the first time series. Furthermore, what I did was, I also cluster the time series according to the what matrix probability. So you can see for the first cluster, the time series tend to select a white noise or random forward drift. For the series in the second cluster, time series tend to select a random walk with drift or ETS trend. So we can see our random forest correctly identify the similarities. For the purple color one, time series tend to select random walk with drift. For the orange color one, equal weight has been assigned to random walk with drift, ARIMA, and ETS trend. For the last time series in the last cluster, tend to select ARIMA and ETS trend because ARIMA and ETS trend, they are very similar. Here in this case also, random walk with drift and ETS trend, they are very similar. Next, what I did was I computed features from all of these time series. I computed 25 features for all of the early time series. Then I have a high dimensional space. In order to reduce the dimension, I use principal component analysis. So based on the calculated features, I reduce the dimension based on the principal component analysis. And here the first three PCAs are plotted. Furthermore, I color the points according to these clusters. So you can see you can clearly see the grouping of the clusters. Grouping of the clusters are clearly visible. So you can see if you go to this end, we have the green, light green ones, and towards the other end, we have the purple and dark green colors one. And just right after the light green, we have the pink color one. So that indicates that our features are useful in identifying the similarities and dissimilarities between the forecast models. Okay, my next question is, which features are the most important and where are they important? How are they important? I'm trying to find answers for these three questions. For that, I use four measurements to evaluate the feature importance. I use permutation-based variable importance, mean decrease in Gini coefficients. Those are the ones that are commonly used in the random forest package. In addition to that, I use partial feature. Feature important measures computed based on the partial dependency plots as well as the individual conditional expectations. Let me quickly show the partial dependency curves and the ICE curves. Individual conditional expectation curves are called the ICE curves. So we have for the illustration, I use a small data set. We have three features. Suppose we want to see how feature X1 is influencing the prediction for the Y1. So for example, if I change, I have two instances, green color one and brown color one, what would happen to the results, predicted results, if I change X1 to 12? For this instance, for the brown color one, what would happen to the results if I change X1 12 to 11? So for that, I created a new data set. And then I pass these data into my train model and obtain the outcome here. Here, if you have a classification problem, you will get the predicted word probabilities. If you have multiple classes, you will get the word probability for each and every class label. For the illustration, I just considered only one class label. And for the average, for the 11 first case, the average is computed based on the first two. For the bottom two rows, average is computed for the last two. Then I draw the ICE curves and the PDP curves. So you can see for the brown color instance, if we change the feature from 12 to 11, this is how the predicted outcome change. And for the green color one, if we change X1 to X12, this is how it's changed. And the red color one is computed based on the averages of the ICE curves. Black color ones are called the individual conditional expectation curves. And red color one is called the partial dependency curve. So here I have only two features. If you have two observations, if you have more than two, your partial dependency plot and ICE curves looks like this. Now, feature important measurement is computed based on the flatness of partial dependency curve. If it is just a flat, and we consider it that it's not an important feature. If there is a high variation, then we consider that feature is very important. So this is the feature importance plot for yearly series. So you can see for the yearly series, for the overall classification, trend is very important. When you go to random walk class, trend is important. Philip Ferron unit truth test statistic is very important because it helps to identify the stationarity and non-stationary. In addition to that, some of the first five partial autocorrelation coefficients are also important. Similarly, if you go for the neural network model, trend is important, Philip Ferron test is important, linearity is important, partial autocorrelation coefficient of the different series is important, as well as the KPSS test statistic is important. So we can identify, I answered to the first two questions, which features are the important and where are they important? This is for the yearly time series. I did the same for the quarterly time series. In the yearly time series, we saw that the trend is the most important feature. But when it comes to the seasonal time series, seasonality is more important than the trend. Seasonality is more important than the trend. In addition to that, for this class, let me go to the Sarema model. Seasonality is important. Partial autocorrelation coefficients of the different series important, and also the autocorrelation coefficients at the seasonal lag is also important. Now my last question is, here I have is, how are they important? So for that, I drew the partial dependency curves. Here I considered only, the question is, when and how are features linked with the prediction outcome? So for that, I used the partial dependency curves along with their confidence intervals. Here I have five classes. First one is ETS model without trend and seasonal component. Second one is ETS model with a damp trend component. And the third one is ETS model with a trend component. Here, this one is for the last three panels, they have a parameter to capture the seasonal component as well. This is ETS model with that damp trend and seasonal component. ETS model with trend and seasonal component. Last one is ETS model with seasonal component. So you can see, as the strength of seasonality increases, the probability of selecting these models increases. And the probability of selecting these models increases because they don't have a parameter to capture the seasonality. So we can see the forms understanding match with our theoretical understanding. So that's helped us to gain trust in using our model. In addition to that, I did for the hourly series as well. For the hourly series, one of the most important features is entropy. Entropy measures the forecastability of the time series. If the entropy value is high, that means the series is very hard to forecast. So you can see the first series entropy value is 0.85. And for the bottom series, the entropy value is 0.44. You can see for that series, we have a nice trigonometric pattern. So if you can see, as entropy increases, the probability of selecting S9 method and white-noise approaches increases, because S9 method means the forecast of the previous seasonal period. White-noise is just the average. So if you don't have a clear pattern, then either you can take the average or the last forecast corresponds to the last period. Random walk with drift and TBATS models, the probability of selecting these models increases as entropy decreases, because random walk with drift is suitable when you have a clear trend, and TBATS models are suitable when you have a nice trigonometric seasonal pattern. Okay, next one is, when and how strongly do features interact with other features? So for that, I use two-way partial dependency plots. The previous one is individual dependency plots. And here I use the partial dependency plots. So here I plotted them for our early series. I have plotted linearity against seasonal ACF, is autocorrelation coefficient at seasonal lag for seasonally different series. You can see the probability of selecting white noise is very high in this case. Dark region shows the high probability of belonging to the corresponding class that I shown here. So if I change the range, you can clearly see the interaction pattern. We can see random walk with drift and white noise. They're kind of having the opposite interaction patterns. And in all these cases, that's a unique pattern of interactivity. If you look at this one, main effect is more powerful than the interaction effect within this region. But even it comes to this corner, interaction effect is more powerful than the main effect. So these things we can identify very easily from these plots. Okay, so far we explored the global view, we look at the model globally, we look at the model as a whole. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to look at local interpretability of the model. That means we zoom into local regions of the data to identify which features contribute most to the classification of a specific instance. So here again, I have a PCA space computed based on the Kotli time series data features. I have selected 4 time series. For the time series, this one here, the best forecasting is Sarima. So you can see the corresponding time series here. Second one, the best forecasting is random walk with drift. Third one, ETS trend and season, that's here. For this one here, we can see the best forecasting method is random walk with drift. And a LIME approach helps us to identify which features contribute most to the classification of the instance. I will enlarge the bottom part. So from this, we can see how strength of seasonality influence the forms framework to select different types of forecast models. For example, you can see for the case one, the best forecasting model is Sarima, and the most influential feature is seasonality. The reason it's between 0.579 to 0.78. So the next one is a random walk with drift. We can see the seasonality is very low for that one. And for this one, ETS trend and ETS model with a trend and seasonal component. So that's because the most contributing influencing feature there is the trend, because this has a very strong trend. And again, for this one, it is ETS seasonal. There's only seasonal component. So we can see the reason for selecting is because that series contains seasonality between 0.787 and 0.895. So from this LIME approach, we can gain insight into the local neighborhood characteristic that lead to the choice of a particular neighborhood over their alternative destination. So with that, my talk comes to the end. And with that, I want to say a special thank you to my wonderful PhD supervisors, Professor Rob Hyman and Professor George Athanasopoulos from Monash University. This was a joint work with them. And thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure. And thank you so much to the YR organizers for all the work you have done getting this ready. And thank you very much for your attention. I'm on Twitter and GitHub under Tianga T handle. You can find my slides, codes on my website. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tianga. That was amazing talk. Let's keep maybe the slide for a bit longer to let people see your social media. They should be also present in the description of your talk on the YouTube. Thank you very much for the talk. This is excellent research, perfect execution. And I have so much questions, but maybe let me, instead of using my chair privilege, I will start with the questions from the chat. So the first question is, does this approach work with the hierarchical time series?
Theoretical time series.
Hierarchical, sorry.
Oh, no. At the moment, in my framework, I didn't explore how this could be expanded into the hierarchical time series. But I saw a paper that recently published by Professor Rob Hyman with one of his postdoc, I think, about extending this algorithm to 4 forecast model selection. So if you go to my supervisor's website, you can find that paper.
The second question is, how does a CRU package deal with missing values in time series?
Okay, that's a good question. Actually, we develop when selecting the features, when computing the features, we compute features, we selected features that do not influence by the missing values. These features are robust to missing values. At the moment, if you have missing values in the time series, you don't need to worry because we just compute features from the time series that do not influence with the missing values. So this is robust framework to missing values.
Okay. Thank you very much. Unfortunately, we don't have time for any more questions. I just want to remind you that Tianga is going to be a panelist during our exciting prediction and forecasting panel. So you could also ask your questions there because I will be putting the questions from the live chat for the chair to decide if they are a good point for discussion. And Tianga, once again, thank you very much. This is excellent presentation, excellent research. And I want to just to mention that this very paper presenting this method has gathered already, I think, like 100 citations in 1 year. This is truly something to, I think, a beginning of something much bigger. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael.